Come on, seriously? There we go.
It's time for Dart Talk, brought to you by thedartzone.com. Stay in the zone. Thedartzone.com is an official Cosmo distributor and Windy City Fabricators, America's premier fabricators of orthotics and prosthetics, and Redwood Darts, America's newest tungsten darts. Stand straight and tall and hit them all. Redwood Darts. And now, here are your hosts, Mystery Mark and Steve P.
Okay, welcome to Dart Talk.
Welcome.
How you doing?
I'm fine. How are you?
Dart Talk brought to you by the Dart Zone.
Stay in the zone.
TheDartZone.com is an official Cosmo distributor. Also, many thanks to Windy City Fabricators, everybody who helps out with the show. Big show tonight.
Big show, big show.
How was your weekend? Before we get to the business at hand.
It was fine, you know.
Little,
it was good,
little
actually.
Chat.
I had a good weekend.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Little golf?
Little golf.
Little R&R?
Yeah. A lot of R&R.
Watching.
Little golf, a lot of R&R.
Do you watch the golf? What do you watch on the weekends when you're kicking back? Are you
baseball.
Watching golf? I do watch
some golf, but I mainly watch baseball, and it depends if the girl's in town, you know. 30,000 steps on Sunday.
30,000.
30,000.
What'd you shoot?
Yeah, I know. That's a problem. No, that was 18,000 was on the golf course, and then still walked a bunch after that.
For all our regular listeners, I was actually on Twitter this week. I tweeted out some picks.
By the way, if I spent 30,000 steps on the golf course, I'd quit.
Oh yeah, you,
yeah. That would.
Where was all the walking from then?
Well, because then we were in the city and we went to dinner. And
oh,
then
okay.
We went to the lake and
oh yeah,
walked around and came home.
I'm all over the lake lately.
Yeah.
You know, now that I'm like realized that I can literally. Within 1,000 steps, there's a driving range.
Mm-hmm.
I actually went to the driving range. I'll leave that story out, but it's scary when I'm walking through the park with one golf club in my hand. People think I'm going to kill them. Okay, so we have a special guest tonight. David Fatum, the international dart star, is going to join us in a little bit. He's waiting in the wings. It was a busy weekend. We've got results from the ADO Championship. They had the 501
yes.
Championship for men and women on Friday, and then they had the big 80 or the big BDO ranked singles on Saturday at the USA Dart Classic. So we can update everybody on that.
And
we
have
the
life.
Women's too, right?
Yeah, and women's, yes.
Yeah, and I misspoke last week. I said you know people were going to go from Stamford and then fly to go play in the PDC thing in Canada. It wasn't the PDC thing. I got a lot of stuff wrong last week. It wasn't the PDC thing.
It was
Dartslive Stage 4.
Right.
So, and we have results from that, too, I think.
We do.
Okay. So, because David is waiting, and he's got, like, league darts or something tonight, I don't want to keep him waiting too long. Let's get right to the results. What are we starting with?
I was going to ask you, which one do you
like? Right, let me queue up a disclaimer, since I have to do the music this week, and you can figure out what we're going to do next.
All right.
The views, opinions, rants, and rampages expressed on Dart Talk do not necessarily reflect individually or collectively those of our sponsors, co-sponsors, wannabe hosts, hearing impaired critics, or those with a penchant for attitudinal dysfunction. We at Dart Talk strive to provide you, the listener, with an educational, entertaining, and fun-filled experience each and every week. If after the show you, the listener, find yourself feeling uneducated, unentertained, and or bored, we at Dart Talk consider that your own problem.
Thanks for that, Aaron. By the way, that disclaimer was actually written by Aaron. He emailed the show and said, hey, I'll do a disclaimer, because we were running the same disclaimer for like a year.
Yeah, right.
Right? And there were a couple of them, actually. So this is what the third iteration. I do like that one. Okay, so what are we going to do?
We're going to do the USA Classic results first.
Okay, so this was the USA Classic results from Stamford, Connecticut.
Right. We will do, let's see, women's singles 501. We got top four. We got Debbie Ivey and Vicky Briggs.
Oh, two of my favorites.
And then,
I haven't seen Vicky Briggs in a couple of years.
Really?
I don't get out to the East Coast anymore. Yeah, apparently Stanford was the place to see her.
And then Robert Curry got second, and Marlise Kiel is your victor.
Okay, congrats to them. Remember, Vicky Briggs, we sponsored a board. They do that charity tournament in Massachusetts. That. I don't think we did it this year. I think I kind of lost. That was my bad.
Okay.
We'll have to double up next year.
Then your men's singles 501. You have top four, Robbie Phillips and Joe Rutsky. Toby Simcoe, second place, and Larry Butler is your winner.
Okay, congrats.
Of the 501 singles.
Congrats to all the participants. How many entries did they have for the
203.
203.
78 for the women.
I would have to say that's not a bad turnout. 203 entries?
That's a lot of people. Your women's singles cricket, top four goes to Trish Gresick and Leslie Joseph, with Robin Curry second and Callie West your winner.
You know,
a couple seconds for Robin Curry.
Yeah, we're going to have to, because I made a note to myself.
Self?
We're not going to have to, note to self. Self? But next week, and so remind me, make a note of this because I'll forget for sure. I want to talk about what are the best rivalries in darts right now.
All right.
And I think, you know, some of them are kind of obvious, but there may be some that we haven't thought of. So maybe we can solicit some suggestions from our peeps.
And then your men's singles cricket, top four, Tim O'Brien and Tom Curtin. And Tom Sawyer second, and Jerry Van Loan.
Jerry Van Loan. Okay. There's a name I haven't heard this year.
Yeah.
Good for him. It's good to see him getting out, winning the cricket.
And that would do it
tough
for your USA.
How many cricket players did they have?
128. 49 in the women.
Yeah, see, you know, it's Sunday. You know, everybody bails.
Everything's low.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so that was
Do the Utes?
Yeah, do the Utes.
The classic Utes results. Girls singles, Amy Lucas, Jenna Yazbek, top four, Hannah McCandless, second, and Karina Reese, first place. Boys singles, Jacob Demers and Zach Ponder, top four, Paul Burke Jr., second, and Dominic Punt.
Dominic Punt is nasty. I have actually seen that kid throw. He doesn't take any prisoners. He's a determined young lad.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's kind of, he's like a mini Freddy Krueger. Swear to God.
Nice.
And he's got, if I remember right, he had these like kind of black rim glasses. He looked lethal.
Okay.
The kid looked lethal last time I saw him play. Congrats to all the Utes that participated. So what's next?
So we got the ADO Championship results.
Right, they had the Friday ADO Championship. What do you got there? Women, men, what do you got?
I don't know, I'm kind of confused now.
Okay.
We'll do the women first. Now it's in bracket form. It completely screwed me up here.
Well, then.
All right, I got it now.
Start from the quarters.
Quarterfinals. So you've got Marlise Kiel beating Candy Ellis. You got Condra Archibald beating Kristen McCandless. Sandy Haas beating Carmen Bishop, and Kelly West beating Debbie Ivey. So you go to the semifinals with Marlise Kiel beating Condra Archibald and Kelly West beating Sandy Haas. And then Kelly West beating the 3 seed upsets Marlise Kiel, the 1 seed, 4-2 for the final.
Oh, my God. They seeded it.
Yeah.
No way.
They did.
I wonder if they've been listening. Well, good. Okay, so Callie West over Marlise Kiel wins the women's 501
correct
ADO championship. Yeah, it is Condra. That's why you got stuck. You thought it was like a typo, but that's actually her name.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's unusual.
Yeah.
All right. How about the?
I tripped all over myself.
Yeah. Well.
So all right. So then we got the men's 501 national or 501 championship and
ADO championship.
ADO championship. So you have Tom Sawyer beating Chuck Pankow. Leonard Gates beating Levi Remick, Robbie Phillips beating Elliot Milk, and Larry Butler beating Dan Naylor.
Wow, Elliot Milk against Robbie Phillips. Those are like the two skinniest guys in the hall.
Okay.
How'd they get paired together? And then you remember Dan Naylor came on the show. He
yes,
won it last
yes,
year. So
yes.
That's a defending champ there.
So Larry Butler beat him, and then Larry Butler proceeds to beat Robbie Phillips. in the semifinals, and Tom Sawyer beats Leonard Gates, and Larry Butler, the 2 seed, is the champion, beating Tom Sawyer, the 8 seed.
So that was seeded too.
Yeah.
So what were who was the top seed?
Jim Widmaier.
Jim Widmaier, and he lost to whom? Did he lose to Pankow?
He lost to the first round or top 32.
I need to give him a call. I wonder how his knee is. I looked at the BDO invitation table, and it looks to me, and I don't know how current it was. It looks to me like he's the top ranked American on the BDO table, but I don't know if that's current. And
just from the seeding, it seems like there's a lot of upsets. I mean, Leonard Gates was 12, Sawyer was 8. They made it semifinals.
Well, yeah, I mean, the seeding's based on, you know, I guess that's BDO seeding. That's where you rank on the BDO table. Or wait, no, this is the, what are we doing here? This is the ADO championship?
Mm-hmm.
This has to be on ADO points then. So Leonard Gates isn't going to be seeded that high because he doesn't play as many ADO events.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So. We really should have done our ranking system. I didn't have time. I mean, I wasn't going to spend 15 hours a week doing the ranking system, but our ranking system, the formula was totally solid. And if anybody wants to, you know, do that next year, feel free. Do you got the guy or the boys or the youths?
The National Youth Championship, Dominic Pundit beat Dylan Graham. These are semifinals. And Carl DeSico beat Tyler Burnett. And then Carl DeSico beat Dominic Punt 4-1 for the final.
4-1 for the final. Okay. Well, congrats
to
the youths then.
They didn't seed that one.
I don't know how you would seed a youth event. I mean, seriously. I don't know how they do the youth events anyway. But congrats to all the people who played. It's good that they have them. I'm all for that. Okay, now you got Darts Live Toronto, which I believe I said it was in Kingston, so I was wrong about that. The list of my errors last week is very, very long. You know how they have like 15 seconds at the end of PTI for all their mistakes?
Yes, yes.
We need like 5 minutes to literally go through everything I got wrong last week. I was so spot on. It was awesome.
All right.
All right, so Darts Live in Toronto was World Stage 4.
Correct.
Okay.
We'll go with we'll start with top 16. You got Scott Boris Kirchmar.
The creature.
John Part, Sean Brenneman, Darren Young.
Sean Brenneman? No way.
In the house. In the top 16. Mitsumatsu Hoshino, Yelly Clausen, Haruki Muramatsu.
Yelly Clausen?
Yeah.
Boy, more and more steel tippers coming over to the soft tip side. Okay. I don't know what that was.
I actually know what that was.
To
the top 8.
Yeah.
Then you got Gordon Dixon, Barry Van Peer, Colin Roloffs?
Okay.
And Paul Lim.
Paul Lim. And that was top 8?
Top 8.
Okay.
Top 4, you have Yuji Iguchi and Leonard Gates.
Okay.
Jeremiah Millar for second place, and your winner would be Sho Katsumi.
Okay, well, congrats to all the participants. Good showing by the North Americans there. You got a guy in the final, a guy in the semi, some guys in the top 8, some guys in the top 16. This is Sean Brenneman, I haven't heard that name in forever.
What does he get him for the stages? I mean, how many stages are there? Do we know?
There's at least 5 because there's one in Malaysia in September.
Well, there's 8 apparently according to this scroll here.
Okay. Well, then what's
it's all
before?
About points.
I don't know.
Well,
to be honest, we'll ask. You know, we'll get David Fatum on and he can explain it to be honest, you know, there's some things that I am not on top of anymore, like I was last year. You know, getting a little distracted doing other things here. So, is that it for the results? Where are we on
that
time?
That is for the results. We can take a break right now.
All right, we're going to take a real quick break, and we will be back with International David Fatum. You listen to Dart Talk with Mystery Mark Steve Ponselman. We'll be back. This will be a short break.
I can help you.
Dart Talk agrees to adhere to the Geneva Convention in treating fairly its prisoners in their war against lackluster darting administration and behavior.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, back for the second quarter of Dart Talk, brought to you by the Dart Zone.
Stay in the zone.
The DartZone.com is an official Cosmo distributor. We have David Fatum waiting in the wings, but I did, and I just felt like it.
Okay.
I mean, was it bad?
No, not at all.
I mean, it's probably illegal. We'll get yelled at by YouTube, but what do we got in the chat room so far?
Before we get to David Fatum here, there was a question. Which Americans already qualified will go to the Masters this year?
Yeah, good question. I don't know. We could effort that during the next commercial. I mean, that's knowable information. There's quite a few of them. I think there's four people that get sent by the ADO, and then there are people that actually qualified because they won BDO singles events. But then you don't know if they're going to go. So I don't know.
Okay.
I don't believe that the list is final for the Masters yet.
And then somebody asked if what's the skinny on the World Cup team? Are we going? Somebody said no, USA in the World Cup. Is that true?
I will effort that as well. I don't know. I mean, I looked at the WDF website. We talked about it last week, and there were only like, you know, 7 or 8 teams going. And I just thought it was the dumbest thing to hold it in Turkey. I don't know how on earth that happened, but, you know, apparently, you know, what I was told was it's being held somewhere that is like not in the danger zone or anything like that. But I don't know.
Now, but you looked at the results, and you said that Jimmy Wood was still above Larry Butler.
I looked at the invitation table that had all the BDO ranking points, but I don't know as of what date.
Oh, okay.
The BDO's website is a mess right now.
Apparently, Larry Butler's overtaken him.
I would think that he had, but yeah. I don't know that to be a fact because it isn't published. Mm-hmm. So until, you know, as a good quasi-journalist, I have to check my sources.
Sure,
so.
Right.
If Larry's number one, it'll be interesting to see if he plays Lakeside.
Yeah.
Because, you know, what I've always heard, and, you know, I'm not quoting anybody, but what I've always heard is that they didn't want him there and that they've been doing all these machinations to prevent him from getting there. I don't know if that's true or not. They're just kind of like the scuttlebutt, you know, when you're hanging around waiting for the next round. So we'll have to see if that's true.
Here we go.
We have American International David Fatum. David, are you there?
I'm here, buddy.
Sweet. Okay. Sorry that we go long sometimes on this show. live.
Not you. Come on.
Live eye casting. How are you, David?
I'm great. It's awesome. I'm glad to be here, actually. For once, I'm excited to talk about the shirt.
Okay, so for the people that don't know you very well, you're currently right now, you reside in the state of Arizona?
That's correct. I live in Phoenix, Arizona, and I'm a paramedic firefighter for the city of Phoenix.
For the city of Phoenix. And then how long have you been living in Arizona?
I've been here since 99, so what, 16 years?
Well, I think 7 years makes you a native.
Where do you hail
you
from?
To California.
I hail from Canada, Prince George, British Columbia. I often have, I actually got in trouble when I was in that, you know, Steve will remember this one, in the PVC US Open, and held up a sign that said, Canadian born, American made.
Right. Yeah, I vaguely.
I got fined 200. You know, I got fined 200 pounds for that one.
I was going to, you know, we're going to get to that because I was really going to, I wanted to ask your impressions of a couple of matches that you played on the second day there after some clown that you played in the top 16 missed a double 15 and let you in.
Yeah, no, who was that? You know, my memory's bad.
Yeah, I try to block that tournament out. So for the people that don't really know you, David, can you give us like kind of a match.com? You know, you're from Prince George, British Columbia. You're married. You've got kids. La-di-da-di-da, whatever you want to share with us.
Yeah, it's funny because, you know, the first lesson I ever got in darts to realize that the guy standing next to you in a dart hall is not your best friend. but only your friend will be standing next to you. A lot of people in the dart world, there's all these stories that float around me, but they don't know who I really am. A lot of people think all I do is play darts, but I was a paramedic, or I'm sorry, I was a physiotherapist, and then, 13 years ago, I switched over to the fire department. Now I'm a paramedic firefighter at City of Phoenix, which is an amazing career that's allowed me to return to darts, really, on that level of where you can just go play whatever you want. I started darts 27 years ago in a little town of 68,000 people, and clawed my way up like everyone else does. But, I love living here in Phoenix. I got a big ranch. I'm married, like you just said. I got married in the last year. Have an amazing daughter, Macy, and lovely wife, Pam, that never says boo about me going away to play dart. And we raise horses. It's a good life,
It sounds rustic. Do you have, like, black widow spiders and stuff out there in Arizona?
Oh, yeah, yes, black widow spiders. You learn that to identify the spider web, and then you can deal with spiders. The one you don't want to get is the brown recluse, because that's the one
those are bad.
Flesh eating disease.
Yeah. Those are bad. Did your wife and child travel with you at all?
Pam comes a lot, but to be honest, she doesn't appreciate some of the things that go in the dart hall. Do you know what I mean? Like
that's completely understandable.
I don't know what he's referring to.
Well, you know how it is. Like, I always tell people, if I got a nickel for every time somebody came up to me and had a real conversation with me and then walked away, and they go to me and go, "Man, I used to think you were a beep until I talked to you." I go, "Well, it's how you approach people." I keep myself distanced from the people in that room, because you're there to do a job and you're out there to be buddies. And everybody just, they get so, it's like high school sometimes.
Yeah, I think, it's kind of funny how it's sort of like the telephone game. Something happens in the dart hall that is misconstrued or misunderstood. Ooh. And by the time it passes through 40 or 50 people, you committed like 7 felonies and barely avoided an indictment. And
it's amazing how the gossip rumors, and they love to change the story.
So, your nickname, I believe, is the Scorpion. Is that true?
This is correct.
Okay, how did that come about?
It's funny. You're just going to kill me now because I can't remember his name. Was the PDC commentator that unfortunately died at an
Sid Waddell.
Early age. Sid Waddell. When I first made my first TV appearance at the PDC, because of being in Arizona, he goes, "He strikes like a scorpion in the desert." I'm like, yeah, that's kind of cool.
Here
we go with it.
Okay. I
think that's a good reason as any.
Sid had a flair for language, and so, to say you got a nickname from Sid Waddell, I would think is pretty cool.
Yeah. Right.
Did you have a nickname before that?
No, it's funny because I started so young. I played my first dart tournament at 19, and I was winning by 20, and they used to call me the kid all the time. And then also, it's a little funny now, being super ancient at 47, looking back on the time I started the game, and you look at young guys and go, "Wow, yeah, I used to do what you did." But there wasn't anything beyond, "Hey, you're playing the kid." But, that worked, and what people don't realize is darts is a business. If you don't have an act, you don't land anything.
Yeah, we're going to have to get to that, after our next break, because I want to go in depth about, kind of the business of darts. We had a very interesting conversation outside of Dayton a month ago, and I want to reiterate some of that stuff. But let's get, some of your dart background in for people that aren't familiar with you. You've been playing 27 years. You started at 19. Can you remember the first tournament you won?
It's the dart tournament that made me a dart star, to be fair. I have to blame the last 27 years on my sister. I got invited to a dart league. I grew up in a dart family, right? So we had dart boards and whatever. And in county, start drinking 19. So you can bar with your buddies, start throwing darts. And my brother-in-law needed a guy to sub on his team one night. So I went out and I threw. I got It was a great league. You played like 9 singles, 6 doubles, and 3 team games. Still the best league I've ever played 27 years later.
Was that Steele?
But anyways, it was Steele. You know, I never saw a soft tip dart. That's a whole other conversation, but, you know, I never saw a soft tip dartboard for the first 10 or 11 years I ever played darts. But I went out and I won one game, and being the kind of A-minus personality that I am, you know, I can't stand sucking. So I went home. I spent 4 hours a day until the next week. And Casey asked me to play, and he asked me to play again. And I won 2 games out of 9. And I was, like, stoked. And then so my sister, at the time, was number 3 in Canada. She goes, hey, there's a mixed doubles event. Why don't you come out and play with me? And I was, all right. And I don't remember if I won or we got second. But we definitely made the finals. And I, you know, so long ago now, I can't remember. But what I do remember is I got an envelope full of money. Anyway, at 19, you're right? And at 19, I went, all you got to do is throw darts and you can get paid like this? I'm in.
So basically, it wasn't just the aggravation of losing, but the incentive of financial gain that kind of hooked you.
Yeah, you know, you're 19 years old, and, like, you got to parlay it to America, like being 21, and go, hey, all you got to do is go to the bar, just make $300, come on out. I'm in.
Well, that's kind of how Mystery Mark got started. You were hustling the college kids, right?
Yeah, it was more for drinks, but there was some cash, but, I mean, you know, we wouldn't spend a dime for 6 hours because we would just constantly win games of darts.
How are we doing on time?
Oh, we got a few minutes, actually.
Okay, because, you know, the money game thing is funny. I played some money games with guys, like, when I was first coming up. And there was one time where they wanted to play doubles for, like, you know, $20 a man. And I was kind of, like, considering it. And then a guy comes up to me, and this is like in the local blind draw we have in Chicago, David. And a guy comes up to me, he's like, dude, don't do it. I'm like, why? He's like, because your partner's going to dump on you, and they're going to split your 20.
Oh,
I'm like,
really?
Oh, really? So then we ended up playing all these weird, like, you know, 50, 60, you know, 25 out, and I buried these guys at every game they thought up. I was so mad. So talking about money games, David, what I heard was that, you know, when darts was big in America, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago, they had all this side money action. They had, like, you know, Saturday night you'd have guys playing for, you know, $500 a piece or something like that. I've never really seen that on the road. Were you playing back then? Can you vouch for this kind of stuff?
Oh, you know, the money game, I can tell you when I started, I used to take an extra $50. And again, I was young and didn't have a lot of money. I'd take an extra $50 to lose, and it was always double. And there were 3 boards. You had to win the first board to get to the second board. If you won the second board, you may get the invite to the third board, which were amazing dart players at the time. And I said to myself, I used to stand back and watch, and I don't think enough players do this today. They don't stand back and watch the nuances that go on in the game. And I would watch those guys just take any game, come up, because all play, oh yeah, and then they would tear them up when they leave. This goes back to your best friend standing next to you while you're standing next to him. And I said to myself, I'm never, ever going to that third board until I'm invited. So one day I'm standing in this tournament hall, and the guy next to me, his name's David as well. David King is his name, great player out of Canada, Western Canada. We're going back a long time. And I looked over, it was Rick Pizarro, Rob Raj. Well, Rick Pizarro was my idol when I started playing darts, because he was the only Canadian player to win the Canadian Open while it was during the real dart era of Raw Heritage. Bob Anderson, Phil Taylor was in there. In the next, that was just when Phil Taylor was starting. And he looks over and he goes, hey, Dave, you want to come play a game? And the guy goes, yeah, man. He goes, no, not you. We want the young guy. And that, I think more players need to do, wait till they're called up. And, I mean, this will take me into something else I want to talk about today, the sponsorships, because everybody wants it so bad that they jump in before they're ready instead of standing back and just learning a little bit more before they step into that pond, because that pond is going to eat you up.
Yeah, it's kind of a different world now. You can kind of promote yourself without having much of a resume, and
kind of
get your name out there.
That's a great thing. I wanted to, there's a girl on the internet and power to her, right?
Only one.
younger female that videotaping herself everything that she does. And now she's got this list of sponsors on her thing. And I, to be honest with you, I don't know her name. I could recognize her face on the thing. But everyone's talking about her because everyone's watching her blog. And I mean, you know, power to her because she's getting sponsors. And sponsors don't care about how good you are, unlike what most people think. Everyone thinks, I'm really good, I should get paid. And you get paid if you can sponsor, if you can sell my product.
Okay, let's take a quick break and come back to this, David, because I do want to talk to you about the business side of darts, and I know a lot of people have some misconceptions about sponsorships, and you can clear that up for us.
No problem. Okay, yeah, especially now that I've shifted over to the ownership side.
Right. Okay, so we'll be back in a minute with David Fatum. You're listening to Dart Talk with Mystery Mark Steve Ponce-Hillman, and this will be another quick break.
You are now and forevermore warned that you consume this show at your own risk, and that Dart Talk cannot be brought to justice in any court or by any government, including and not restricted to the Grand Spaghetti Monster of the Triple 20.
Okay, back for the second half of Dart Talk, brought to you by the Dart Zone.
Stay in the zone.
DartZone.com is an official Cosmo distributor. It's my fault. I didn't mention to David the thing about the hot mics.
Yes.
So, David, we can hear you on the phone.
Well, I was waiting for you to respond.
Well, I can't respond because we're running
breaks.
Yeah, see, during the breaks, we run music, and I don't think you can actually hear the music on the phone. So you're just probably hearing silence. But actually, we have kind of just sort of like boilerplate music that runs during the break. So sorry about that. I should have warned you.
I know. I got a text that said nice music, though. So you guys aren't doing so bad.
Okay. Well,
hold on. Hey, David, so somebody asked, since scorpions glow blue and green in certain ultraviolet wavelengths, do you glow under a black light?
I definitely do glow under a black light because that means I'm usually lit up and in the club.
There you go. See, we have the smartest chat room in the business, and hello to some old friends that have popped in. I see Mason in there.
Somebody else,
the original friend of the show,
in the chat said the name of the girl you're talking about on the website promoting herself is Jennifer Mounts. Now,
yeah, you know what?
Is that true?
You know what? She's really, yeah. That is, now that you said it's the name, it's correct. And
it sounds so fake.
Example, but you know what? You know, what she's doing is what we're about to get into is about, you know, everyone thinks there's this entitlement in America that goes, you know, I'm really good, so you should give me $5,000 like play darts. But if I give you $5,000 as a company, you need to make me $15,000.
Yeah,
What Jennifer Mounts is doing is she's drawing in people. When you draw in people, you can sell products, and that's why her shirt's blowing up. And you know what? I have all the respect for her. And she's taking it to the next level of that. But I want to go back to the days when me, Chris White, and Rob Hackman were the first guys to come out with websites and stuff like that, that drew in the sponsors that led us to where we are today.
Yeah, we can talk about the in chronological order, kind of how things developed. I remember speaking with, I don't remember if it was Rob or Chris, but they were basically saying they were the ones that started all the Cosmo and all this, and you know, we could talk about that. When it comes to sponsorships, let me run something by you. Because there was a guy in the news in Chicago. He got $210 million over, I don't know, like 10 years, for his signature basketball shoe, right?
Wow.
And the idea that he's going to sell that many shoes at, you know, he signed it when he was an MVP rookie and then tore up his knee and, you know, didn't play for a couple of years. And now it's to the point he can't make the USA basketball team. And there's a rumor that, you know, Reebok is trying to get some of its money back or somehow get out of the deal. You're talking about dart players in association with companies where rather than, well, hey, I'm a good player, give me money to play. What you're basically saying is I'm a good player. I have an image, I have a presence, and people know me. I can represent your products and increase your sales. Sponsor me is kind of what I think what you're getting at.
You said two things that were complete opposite in that conversation. And let's start back with the basketball player. What Reebok would have done was hedge their bets, right? They're going, you may become the next brilliant superstar. So let me pay you now before somebody else does, and I'm willing to roll the dice.
Right.
The problem in the world of dart is where I see it, okay? And I've been around a long time, and you're right. And give credit where credit's due. Robert Heffington brought Cosmo Fit Flight to America. And everyone that has any type of association with Cosmo or Fit Flight should send Robert Heffington a thank you letter. You know what I mean? Because it all started there. And I'll even take it one back farther than that. Where the first real sponsors walked up to us when we walked up stage, and it was back in Metals. When Metals was big, and I mean, we're going back. I wasn't even living in Arizona, so it's got to be 15, 16 years ago. I walked off the stage losing the ninth leg to Robert Heckman, all upset about it. Walked past Peter, who owns Puma Dart, and he's had his hand shaking out. You know how it is that first 5 minutes, you just want to, when you blew a match, you just want to go by. I went by him, and Rob stopped, and he talked. Rob signed a big deal. Rob went on to signing more big deals. And that's some of the things that people have to realize, that this, the things that everyone are doing now started so long ago, but they think today's thought process doesn't quantify. Does that make sense? Like, everyone sold their souls now. You know what? I get people writing me, because I represent Tenatory, writing me all the time going, hey, you know, give me a shirt and 5 sets of darts and I'll wear your shirts around so I can say I'm sponsored. How do you get paid after that?
Yeah, a couple of things. I mean, I've always thought that, you know, because the players were never organized as a group and could never collectively bargain, that all these bad deals that they were cutting was going to kind of hurt everybody. If you're willing to, if everyone's willing to, you know, work for nothing, then no one's going to get paid. So
yeah.
I'm not criticizing anybody's deals. I mean, it just seemed to me that the lack of organization and the lack of everybody kind of getting together and being like, hey, you know, we should all hold out for more kind of a deal, you know, kind of hurt the players in the long run. The other
You know
thing.
what, I don't give many props, you know, to Gary Mawson, because everyone knows me and Gary are, we're better now than we used to be. You know what? Gary Mawson had a deal with Cosmo Darts, and because Cosmo and Fit Flight, like, there's two different sections. Cosmo owns Fit Flight, but Cosmo is a barrel company, and he was with Cosmo. And because so many players start going, hey, you know what, I'll do my stuff for free. Just give me 5 sets, give me 10 sets, give me 2 shirts, give me 25 sets of flight. They started cutting back on the players that got paid. And I'll give props to Gary, because Gary, they came to Gary and said, hey, listen, you're not really playing a lot anymore, but he's still Gary Mawson. He's still the guy that went to the UK Open finals. He's won a lot of stuff. And then in any given day, the guy's going to win a dart tournament. He said, you know what? I won't sign for that anymore. So I'd rather not have a sponsorship than sell my soul. And so, you know what? I give him props because he walked away from a deal. And the problem is, until dart players, you can't organize dart players per se as a general scope. But, you know, until dart players start realizing that when you start signing on for product only, you're never going to get paid.
Well, talking about getting paid, you know, you were talking earlier about dart players telling businesses what they could do for them. And also you referred to that you're on the ownership side. Talk about that a little bit. What are you owning and what is that like?
Well, you know, it's funny because it's dipping into the soft dip world. And we need to backstory it a little bit. Like when guys come up and say, hey, I want to be sponsored, I want to get paid. What people have to realize in America is that in North America, Canada and USA, we're dealing with 150,000 competitive dart player market. Maybe it's a little higher, it's not. The big market in America, in North America, is the basement players. So me paying you money is never going to promote my basement players. But you go to the city of Hong Kong alone, there's 500,000 dart players. You go to Japan, there's 2.1 million registered dart players. You go to a dart tournament in Japan where they pay a trophy, nearly 6,000 people show up to play a tournament. So where's the market in dart? You know what I mean? And people got to realize that when they're over here feeling entitled because I'm really good that I should get paid. Well, yeah, your buddies are going to buy 100 sets. It's not going to move it. So fast forward to your question was, I'm sitting in the world stage coming off a semifinal, I think it was, and a new dart company comes up to me because I got banned. What people don't realize is that I signed a really, really, really good deal with Trinidad Dart. But I got banned by Dartslive. So I wasn't allowed to play the Dartslive tournaments anymore. And I didn't really care at the moment because I was in Japan playing the D-Crown Tour. And, you know, and there was a lot of money there. And I went with the attitude, I went, you can't, like, hold me over a barrel and say, if I sign for this, after you told me, they told me it was okay to sign a deal with them, checked with them first, that now I'm no longer playing the highest profile marketer in the world. I went, well, screw that. But luckily, put it out, said, you know what, we'll let you out of your contract at any given moment when you want to go back. And so I remember the conversation standing in the, it was the grand final that time, standing there, and a guy comes up to me and goes, so is it worth it? I said, I don't know. If I win today, it's $135,000, and I'm pretty sure that's worth it, you know? So I left without a sponsor, and then this guy, little tiny guy, comes up to me. His name's Yang Yang, who's now the owner. He wasn't at the time, Tianatori Dart. And came up and says, hey, look at my product. What do you think? I said, I think we can do something. I said, just let me help you shape. And they couldn't afford what the going rate was because if you're not going to get paid in America, you have to play in Asia. And so we did a deal. We did a deal where I got a percentage of the dark company versus taking money. And that's the long version versus the short version. Because short-sightedness, sorry. People today only, they want the shirt, they want the five sets of darts and go, I'm with X brand, versus looking at themselves going, what can I do for myself over the next 10, 15 years? And I think that's the definition of professional. When you're a professional, you look at, how is this good for me in my entire life? So, long-winded answer, but the short answer was, you know what, I needed somebody and they needed somebody to represent them. And then I was in Super Dart, so I went on to what I think was the top eight. I took a company that was nothing, and in 5 minutes in Japan with 2.1 million players, and they buy the DVDs and all those things. We launched Tianatori Dart, and here we are today.
Pretty cool.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. Yeah, it's interesting, you know, you're talking about, you know, short-term, long-term decision-making. I don't see a lot of long-term decision-making in a lot of this stuff. That I've seen. Where are we on time? Because I want to ask him about this one thing.
Go ahead.
We were talking earlier about money games, and I hear that there's like a real big money game coming up, I want to say in November.
Yeah, you're right. It's the Red Rhino Premier Cup.
The Red Rhino Premier Cup.
Yeah, $2,000 buy-in, $15,000 first prize. And it all started with a conversation with the owner of Red Rhino saying, hey, if I can get six guys and put up $2,000, I'll throw five extra grand in. And all of a sudden, you had 16 players putting their money out.
Okay, so 16 times 2 is 24.
What?
No, I'm sorry, 32.
Yeah.
I've been wrong about a lot this month.
That went to the blooper reel.
All right, so 32, and you said the winner gets 15?
Correct.
That's 7.5 to 1.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an electronic tournament? What's the format?
It is. You know what? You know, this is something I hope we have enough time to talk about. It's soft tip versus steel tip. Because when that tournament first came out, you know, everyone was tagging me on that stuff. And I'm not that active on Facebook anymore because you max out 5,000 friends, and now it's not no longer a personal thing, it's about a business thing. And I looked at it, my playing schedule, my life schedule with my wife and how our life is away from the game was that, I go, if you give me some dates, you give me the format, then I'll commit to it. But all these guys are going, I'm in for $2,000. I go, well, that may be nice, but I got to spend an extra $1,000 or throw $2,000. Let me know what it is. The thing I hate about soft tip, and the reason why I dropped off the Dartslive World Tour this year was, I'm over shooting at a fat bowl and spending $2,000 a weekend, travel around the world, to shoot at a fat bowl when you get a little, you touch your flight and now you're off into the one and you're no longer with the game because that's basically what it is. So I was out. I guess a few guys dropped off or something happened. I got a phone call and they said, hey, listen, the event now is Best of 11, split bowl, double out with cricket. Are you interested? I went,
whoa,
well,
wait
yeah,
a minute.
Yeah, I'm interested.
It's soft tip?
Split bowl double out with cricket.
Exactly. That's what I said. I'm in. Here's my $2,000.
Wait a minute. So you're playing half cricket, half 0-1, but the 0-1 is a split bowl and a double out like a normal steel 0-1 game.
Correct.
So you'll be shooting, I would think, at the triple 20 mm-hmm. on an electronic board and doubling out like normal.
Correct.
Okay, and then you're also playing cricket. That's the one with the X's and O's, right?
And alternating starts.
And alternating starts. Best of 11.
So if you call yourself a professional, how could you not get involved in the Premier Cup when it's given to you?
Well, I would say initially that, you know, the $2,000 buy-in some people would balk at.
Well, you know what? And I said that. And after, you know, they came out. I'll give Red Rhino credit. I'll tell you what. I've known Red Rhino since they were like a little website that was, hey, come into my town. I'll find you a dart tournament, blah, blah, blah. Then they branched off to doing a little bit of shirts. And they made themselves a brand. Red Rhino now is a legitimate brand, whatever they want to do with themselves. And I think the future of darts is in production of darts, and that's where they're at.
In the production of barrels or in the production of dart events?
No. I think if you really want to get rich in the dart game, you have to be involved in the production of darts. There's no way that you can tell me that we cannot come up with a television product. The problem is, it's what people keep doing and tournaments keep doing is they have the same pile of bleed and they shine it up and go, this is a new pile of bleed. And that's what's...
What I mean? That little white dot on top of the chicken poop. Don't forget, it's still chicken poop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can polish a turd, but it's still a turd.
Well, let me run this one by you, and then we'll take a quick break, and we'll come back to this. But I was channel surfing the other night, and remember I told you that there was this thing on A&E Network. It ran for like 5 weeks, and it was all these like team arm wrestlers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think ESPN had like the World Arm Wrestling League tournament. Whereas the same dude, this big left-handed dude from Pennsylvania, who's like the super heavyweight world champion arm wrestler, and this is on ESPN. Now the match literally took it was best of three, and it only went twice. He argued with the referee for 50 times longer than the actual matches took. He took the guy down twice, and the elapsed time combined was less than a second. And they're selling this on ESPN. Mm-hmm. You telling me you can't sell a dart tournament or a right. dart event with something like that? We're going to come back, and then I got insulted by somebody who
you
listens.
You gotta give me a chance to address why darts is on television. I've done
okay.
a lot of work on that.
All right, let's come back, and we'll talk about televised darts. You listen to Dart Talk with Mystery Mark, Steve Ponce-Elman, our guest David Fatum, and we'll be right back. This will be another short one. Don't talk until we come back, David.
The views and opinions expressed on Dart Talk are those of the hosts. They in no way should be misrepresented, misinterpreted, or made a claim that the universe is against you, your family, your city, or the darting community at large.
Okay, back for the fourth quarter of Dart Talk, brought to you by the Dart Zone.
Stay in the zone.
DartZone.com is an official Cosmo distributor. Also, thanks to Windy City Fabricators, Melissa, Aaron, Sam, the intern, and all the people that help with the show, and of course, you, the listeners. Thanks for tuning in. We still have David Fatum, American International, or I guess, should
who
I say?
Apparently, whispering is different than talking.
The Dart Whisperer. Do we say American International, David? What's the most accurate way to describe it?
Well, people always ask me because I've been representing Canada in the USA, and unfortunately, I keep representing the U.S. Canada a lot more. And because when you travel internationally, you travel on your passport. So what I like to say is Canadian-born American made.
Okay, but do you travel under a Canadian passport?
I do.
Okay. So if I said Canadian internationally, I wouldn't be wrong. I mean, I don't want to mischaracterize anything.
You're not wrong either way, right?
I've always been confused.
Like, I've had this conversation with other players, and a guy said to me, it was Andy Hamilton. He goes, "Hey, if I move to America, does that make me American when I stand there and I talk with my accent?" No, I'm always going to be Andy Hamilton from England. So, right or wrong, it is what it is, right?
Okay. Well, do you have a preference?
No, I have zero preference because, like I said, I live here, you know, and I work for the fire service. I love taking care of this country, and I'll do anything it takes to take care of this country. But at the end of the day, you're still Canadian.
Right.
So if Canada plays USA in the hockey, in the Olympic gold, go USA.
Okay. See, I think that's the tiebreaker there. I think if we're playing Canada... Are you a Phoenix Coyotes fan? Do you follow any of the teams out there?
Oh, yeah, yeah. You know, a long story. We don't have time for that stuff. But I used to work in hockey when I was a physical therapist. And I remember how I know the Phoenix Coyotes is because they used to be the true Winnipeg Jets. And they're in history with having the longest playoff game ever. So I love them.
Yeah, they had Bobby Hall. They got Bobby Hall, Winnipeg, when there was it, the WHL.
Yeah, and they also haven't won a playoff series playoff game in how many years?
Hey, you know, I root for the Cubs. Yeah. I mean, that sort of thing I find irrelevant. Okay, so Okay, so we're going to talk about like the darts on TV thing. You've given this a lot of thought or worked in it in some capacity.
Yeah, you know what? I'll be straight up honest about it. About 2 years ago, I started buying up cameras and computers that I thought could, so how I could do a televised event the right way. And the problem is, and like we addressed it earlier, is that people keep doing the same thing over and over and thinking they're going to get a different result. You're never, people try to copy the PDC. The problem with the PDC is what people don't get is, let me ask you this, Dave. What is the driving force behind the PDC? Why is the PDC so successful?
It's a great night out for the
keep
fans.
Keep going. Why is it a good night out?
Because they have a good time. I mean, they dress
it's called,
up like
it's called
like
legalized gambling. They have
okay. Well, that was the other thing
gambling.
Is they wager on the matches.
They don't wait. You don't even. It's like playing craps. You don't look like you can play craps going over and under, right?
Yeah.
You can go to PDC match and watch a match and say, "Well, yeah, I picked Fatum to beat Mardell. And that wasn't a good bet that night. But how many 180s you want to hit? How many green doubles are hit? How many red doubles are hit? How many shots over 121? I mean, you can
see you're all over
any
this.
Way you want.
Yeah. See that you're right up Mark's
that's
alley.
That's the side of dark.
Yeah. Mark's like all over. He bets on baseball games, and I'm not sure he knows who's pitching. He just decides, I'll take the over in this game or the under in that game. And well, you know,
exactly, because you can take a pitcher and go, is he going to throw 90 pitches or is he going to throw 100 pitches?
Right.
You can bet that. Well, that makes it interesting, so you're going to watch it. That's why darts is the number two thing on television in Europe. But
it's the Super Bowl on steroids because that's when you get all the prop bets for the Super Bowl.
Yeah, you don't really get them for normal stuff.
It's prop bets galore
every match
all the time.
See, I didn't know that you could how many green doubles?
Yeah.
I got to think now. Wait, double one's green, 16's green, 4's green, 5's green.
Yeah.
How many red ones? 10, 20, 8?
It's called
two.
Half the board.
Depends
well,
on the
yeah,
board.
But
you don't
have to I mean,
you go 10-10.
I would have to figure. Yeah, you don't throw a double 14 very often. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't throw a double 13 very often. So I'd have to look, and I never thought about that. Green and red.
That would take a. that's a lot of options. So
well, if Taylor's playing,
so they're all in there. All these people watching this are, for the majority of them, have all these prop bets going on, like various things of how many triples and how many darts are going to be thrown.
The thing was, see, here's the thing. Like when I was involved, you know, when I was still one of the guys in Dartslive, was I met with the guys that out of England that do all of that, and they were looking to bet the World Tour. And I was excited about that because you introduced betting to the World Tour. Now, you're not talking about playing for $12,000, $10,000. You start talking about betting. So you're playing for $50,000. And I don't know where that's at now. I mean, Dart, like we already talked about, Dart Live has had some changes and some things have changed, which elected me to get out. But the betting's the future. Now, you know, in America, we have such hypocritical rules, but we have what's nice to me is that we run so many events in Vegas and we don't run betting in Vegas. How can you, like, I was at the last CDC in St. Louis and there was a guy running Calcutta.
So,
yeah.
I was a high seller on Calcutta and I walked up and told him, I said, don't bet on me today because I'm so angry about what we're doing today. Don't bet on me.
What
are you saying that if I could get a series of what they do overseas and take it to the next CDC event? Granted, it will be completely illegal because it's illegal to gamble in the States.
Yeah,
like
and it's not something that we're recommending anyone do
right,
at home.
But if I actually like set up shop, do you think that it would create a greater, you know, environment for people to watch?
Absolutely.
I gotta tell you.
So
the
I could get a bunch of, like, we're always talking about how nobody's watching the finals.
Yeah.
I could get If I can, that's, get a little, that's the future.
Literally, get a notebook and a pen.
Right, and start
and
walking.
And yell out what the odds are and see if you get any takers.
I went to, we haven't talked about this, but I don't usually play in America very much for the last few years. Because I have no sense. Why would I pay $700 to go win $1,000 for a weekend?
I remember you telling me that. I've quoted you on that numerous times.
$1,500 to go play for $10,000, right? That makes more sense. Because you only have to get one out of 10 and you're way ahead. But in America, people get on plane, they fly out, and they do 2 out of 3, which 2 out of 3 is a coin toss. Now, let's talk about the great DVC Tour. Can it be better? Yes. Is it a great event? Terrific event. Went to St. Louis. I wasn't really happy with what happened in St. Louis. Sorry, my dog's playing with me.
What happened in St. Louis?
They ran to Calcutta. They ran to Calcutta, which made the whole event different because everyone in that room cared about every match that happened. Because you're buying players.
Right.
Calcutta's fun.
I got to tell you something
go ahead.
Just real quick. The first time I showed up at Family Bar for a blind draw, I think I won or something. And a guy came up to me. You don't know him. He's not around anymore, David. But he's like, would you cheat on a Calcutta? And I'm like, I don't know. What's a Calcutta? I had no idea what it was. And he's like, well, they do this. And he explained it to me. And he's like, so would you like... You know, if somebody came up to you and said, you know, would you not win and I'll give you money, would you do it? I'm like, no. Like, I came here to win, man. You guys do what you want, you know, kind of thing.
That's a character issue, right? When somebody approaches you with that, and that's the downside of betting.
You're going to have that anyway.
Me and you happen to get to a top four again and play me, and I'd be happy to say, hey, Steve, you're going to lose anyway. You might as well take a dive right now and make money.
Oh, well. I could see the guys really getting into it. I mean,
having fun with you.
Yeah,
no,
I know.
But,
I mean,
you know, it depends. It's like trying to fix things like a Calcutta, though, is more difficult because you have your number one seeds and then you have people coupled together and everything's paid.
Yeah,
you can't necessarily fix that as easily as you can. Well,
I think the point that he's making though is that there's this extra layer of interest when you can wager on a game.
Well,
look at pro football.
That's why NFL. The NFL.
Yeah, look
so
at pro
huge.
Football. If Vegas didn't have point spreads and you couldn't bet the over under or you know whatever they do, the Super Bowl's nuts with the prop bets. I mean, where would the NFL be today?
Right.
And yet they don't want to allow gambling anywhere but Vegas. Like Atlantic City tried to
get
it.
Doesn't make sense.
And I'm kind of like, how did this happen? You know, because every state, you know, when they passed these laws for Vegas, I don't know how many decades ago, but since then every state has like figured out some way to run a lottery, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like how many church bingos are running? Right? Isn't bingo gambling?
As far as I know, it is. Yes,
you're right.
So
and this was the conversation I had when we were at the Barracks, and it was funny because I was sitting in there with the owner of 9dartout.us, Ken McGowan, who's in the CDC. I said, you know what the CDC really needs is a legalized gambling. Because now CDC, if anyone's calling themselves a dart player that doesn't play, Steve, you know, you showed up. Long format is what everyone begs for. 2 out of 3 point toss. If you call yourself, you win a dart tournament and win 2 out of 3, I say you won 7 coin toss. But yeah,
we've been saying
CDC
that for a while.
Yes, right.
Yeah. What the CDC needs is that legalized gambling part. Because right now, as much, and I'm from, the only reason you even talking to me is I'm promoting the CDC. I mean, I'm spending my $1,000 a weekend. I'm going out to those dart tournaments, and I've had a little success, which is great. I'm having this success because it's a long format. Your experience gets to come into play. But the thing is why I'm there, why like Darren Young's there and Larry Butler's there, or the Mitch Paytons. Let's talk about the Mitch Paytons and the Roger Carters that are showing up, or the Scott Buckleys that are showing up, the guys that are not even playing darts anymore. They're coming out and molding this dart tournament because we all agree that this is the best shot for Americans to play for $10,000 a weekend.
Yeah.
And that's where it's at.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of, a lot of people, I think, are kind of waiting to see if it succeeds before they jump in. I think there's plenty of more players where those guys come from. I think it's great that Roger comes out and Mitch comes out.
I want to jump in. And I hate to interrupt you on that.
Go ahead.
I want to jump in. And either way, I'm not shy about calling guys out because you are what you say, right? Steve, you stand behind what you say. And if I open my mouth to the dart room or to whatever room, I own it. I walked up to Jim Windmeyer and Tommy Sawyer and go, where are you guys? And go, well, this is going to feel like everything else.
Yeah.
If it doesn't feel, I'll come around after.
Well,
you take ownership in promoting dart and getting what you want?
They are getting what they want.
There and go, you know what, Tom Sawyer? I'm the best triples player there is in the world. Like, come on. Let's get serious.
People can disagree, and you know the guys that are on the East Coast have a lot of action and don't really have the geography issues that you may face, and they have plenty of local stuff, and because they're so like in the ADO kind of world, that's all they care to promote, which I'm not going to hold that against them. I think it's short-sighted. And I think that, you know, at some point, you know, when this takes off, there, I would have serious questions about letting people like that participate, but that's not for me to decide. That's just kind of like how I look at it. Plenty of good players.
Yeah, and that's a great point because, you know, that's one of those conversations that comes every year. I'm going, oh, you should go play this guy for $5. He's great. And I go, like, there's lots of good players. But the only good players that count are the ones that show up when it matters.
Well, yeah, I mean...
You know, in the TV-
It's kind of funny. I've started to notice that there are sort of like Facebook pros that talk a lot about darts on Facebook and la-di-da-di-da and try to promote themselves. I think that's great. I don't have anything against it, but I just am sort of astounded. I got called out by a guy who ended up insisting that we play for $2,000. And finally, I was like, okay. You know, I was just sort of like, seriously? All right. You know. And
you know, that's the funny thing to me, because when the guy calls me out $2,000, I'm going, I'll play for $5. If you don't want to play me for $5, you never wanted to play me at all.
Yeah, I just, you know, the whole money thing is just like in Chicago, I couldn't get a game for $1 for years. Even like my practice buddies and stuff.
I don't know about that. I mean, if when you say something like, I'll play you for $2,000, and you say, I'll play you for $5, it's more, you know, the more important thing is you walk up to somebody and say, I want to play you for money, and then you say, how much are you willing to lose? You know, that makes it more interesting.
Well,
I mean, because if you're willing to lose $2,000, you'll play, because that's when the nerves set in.
Yeah, that was Jordan's thing. Jordan was always like, how much you want to play for? He's like, well, what'll make you nervous?
Yeah.
And then let's play for that. And I mean, you know, what I heard.
And that's a great, not to interrupt, but that's a great game of the Red Eye Rhino series of the Premier Cup, right? Like everyone's going, oh, I'm going to drop my $2,000. It wasn't until I did my interview the other day that I realized. Well, these guys have backers. I think there's going to be three of us that stand in there and pay the $2,000.
Right.
So run the details by me on this because I'm a little hazy on this. There's 16 guys.
Like I said, Red Eye Rhino, I think, is the best thing that's happened in America. They're doing their own thing, which is what you like. I'm on the business side of darts. Everything I look at darts now is about a business. Red Eye Rhino started off as they thought they were this one thing, which was a dart website. Then they launched into something else. It became insurance. Then they became a promotional company, and they're running these dart tournaments with their soft dip, which is great to whatever, because, I mean, there's way more soft dippers than there is anything else. And now they're launched off into the production of dart. And like I said before, I think the true money in darts is being able to produce a sellable product. I don't think it's happened yet. I think because everyone wants to do everything live. I think the true value in dart for America is to be like the TV shows that we're talking about when we're looking at bowling. And you don't watch bowling live. It's post-production because you go, they can sit there and say, hey, I don't like that interview. Because here's how interviews work, right? When I was playing at the level of, oh, yeah, I'm going to play Steve. Steve's a great, talented dart player. He's won a lot of stuff. I just want to go out there and do my best job that I can do. If I do my job, I'll be happy at the end. It's really boring. Who wants to watch that?
Not me.
Who wants to go?
And I know for a fact that that's not what you think. So I have a second layer of incredulity.
What's wrong with seeing what you think, right?
There's, well,
I go, you know what? He should sit back on his talk show and stay and watch me, a true professional, do what I do. Because he doesn't have a game to hang with me. So you know what? This is pretty much a walkover. So I'm going to walk over there and do what I got to do. And then they cut to Steve and they go, Steve, well, Adam's busy raising horses. I don't know what he's doing now. I mean, he's getting old. He looks a little fat. So let's watch and see what happens. I mean, I don't care if you play darts or not. You're going to stop and watch because you're going to see a fight.
There, right? Well, and again, like, you know, the mano on mano, I mean, I don't think we have to be like, you know, Hulk Hogan and the worldwide wrestling and stuff like that. But there is a certain element to, you know, going head to head. That, you know, you could take advantage of if we went away from the kind of formats that we have in most of these tournaments, where one of the things we complain about is, like, let's say there's a tournament next week and we want to talk about it. We don't know who's playing who.
Yeah.
So talking about it in advance is almost impossible. And then you talk about it afterwards. Well, what if, like, the top four guys are out in the first round and now who won? What's his name? Where's he from? Can I get him on the phone? I don't know who he is. You know, so, I mean, we don't have, like, it's so hard to cover darts as a sport for us that something like the CDC is, like, so much more organized. And it's like, okay, well, okay, here's who's seated. Here's who's playing who. Okay, there's enough names where you can kind of keep everybody straight. And if somebody starts qualifying regularly, you could kind of be like, okay, well, here's a new guy. And now you have, like, a collection of players that you can talk about in the same familiar way you talk about the Phoenix Coyotes or the Arizona Cardinals or the Blackhawks or whoever.
You know, and you're exactly right. A lot of the things, when I've called out a few players about not showing up to these events, you know, Tom Sawyer, Jim Lindmeyer, Mike Maloney, you know, these are in the Midwest.
Who?
In their wheelhouses. And they go, hey, I didn't get a tour card. I went, you know what? I didn't get a card. David Fatum, 7-time world champion of soft hit, done the PDC thing, won all those titles. I didn't get one. I sent them an email, say, hey, I want to be a part of your tour. What do I need to do? They go, well, you don't play in America anymore, so we didn't think you'd be interested. If you're not interested in promoting yourself, and that's what people as dart players have to realize, if you don't get involved in the CDC tour, you have no right to what's going to happen 2 years from now.
Yeah.
And that's what you were talking about earlier.
Well, it's kind of like, you know, the people that are out there at the beginning, I don't know, should get some consideration. I mean, I'm sure it'll all work itself out. And, you know, you mentioned Mike Maloney, and he's actually from the Chicago area. I think he's out in Joliet. And he posts a lot on Facebook and stuff, but
he is. He's a highly visible player.
He's a highly visible player, but I was kind of thinking, well, this is designed for
hard.
A guy like him. This whole thing, I figure, is way more advantageous to the people that are, like, under 35 than the people over 50.
Hey, I'll tell you this. When I go play in Asia, the average age under 25. All those people in those darts.
Yeah, I mean,
and,
it's...
And I got nothing... And let me say this out loud and proud. I got nothing against Mike. Mike's brilliant. Mike's brilliant on the internet. He's a great dart player and things like that. And I had the same conversation with Mike. Going, when you be loud and proud, you become a target.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm sure he can own that. He's a nice guy. He's a good player. I mean...
No, he's a great
you know,
guy.
I don't see him post anything objectionable.
It's a great game. It talks to one of those things that you guys have talked about before. I'm not saying that this applies to him, but the pub player versus the pro player, or pub player versus traveling player.
Okay.
I'm thinking Heath, because I've called players before. And went, you're a great pub player. And they don't understand the difference that when you get on a plane, you go to a hotel, and you know you're in a new venue. How do you succeed there? And that's the next level. I even say this to guys that are great American dart players. They go, hey, I'm coming over to Hong Kong. I'm like, great. So how are you getting from the airport to the hotel? Where'd you get a hotel? Do you know how you're getting from the hotel to the venue where you're going to play? Do you know how long it's going to take you? Do you know where you can go eat? Do you know where you can find money? Do you know how much English is in there? And these are all the things that players don't think about when you step up to the next level every time. That there's a whole new mix. Now, what are you going to do when you walk into a room with 128 players that can win the dart tournament? What are you going to do then? Because you're nobody here.
Yeah, it's interesting. The life of the traveling dart player. I remember one of the first golf hustlers I ever met when I was very young. Would always, instead of saying good morning, Steve, how are you? He would always say the same thing to me, and he'd be like, hey, what's your best road game? Right? And I didn't really get it. He said it to me, I don't know, 50 times before I started to understand what he was talking about. You know, and that's kind of what you're saying is like, you know, a good bar player who's, you know, always plays well in comfortable surroundings, that doesn't always translate. You know, basement players that are throwing all these ton 80s at home and then go out on the road and are throwing 26s seem confused. There's a certain, I don't know if it's a maturation process or a level of professionalism for guys like you that can take it on the road and still perform despite all the inconveniences you were talking about.
It's exactly what you just said. You know, it's about a different level in understanding what that level you're at. You know, when you step into a new room, it's a maturation process. And what I hate hearing about players, you know, when I'm a little bit better, I will go there. The problem is I think we alluded to this earlier. I used to take $50 to a dart tournament when I was horrible and was doubled. And I'd walk up to guys and I'd say, hey, could you play doubles with me to play this match right now? I'm up on board too for the money game. Because why? You'll never win. I went, but if I don't play, how will I know what it takes to win?
Yeah.
So if you don't enter, you'll never know what it means to be that good.
You'll never get that good until you start knocking heads with the good players.
Right.
So I think what you're saying is, you know, the guy that says, well, I'll go when I'm better, isn't going to get better without going. That's the kind of paradox
you're
I think
never
you're talking
be
about.
Better. You're never going to have that experience that it takes. It's like when I went over to the PDC when I first went over. Guys were going, why would you go over there? I went, why would I spend $500 to fly up to New York to play for $800 when I can spend $600 to fly to England and play for $20,000 against the best players in the world? Which one of us is going to get better faster?
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. The guy that says, I'll go when I get better has no inclination
You'll
of getting
be
better.
Better.
They don't
that's the pub player.
Want to get better.
Well,
they don't have the aspirations.
That's the definition of the pub player. Right.
But there's
my pub.
Yeah. There's nothing wrong with being a pub player. As long as you're not misrepresenting.
I'll tell you this. 27 years looking back, everything I've done, all the money I make now, and all the money I've made, I wish I had never left the pub.
Why is that?
Because I've given up so much of my weekends to go fishing and camping, so many relationships, so many times that those life experiences. You thought that weekend was the time when you went to Tuckyuckduck, Alaska to play darts to win that title. Then it made a difference. And then when you get on the crown of the jewel, you start standing there. Then you start looking at it. Well, yeah, if you're Phil Taylor, that made something. And that's where you don't see me. We didn't talk about it really, but I don't play local darts anymore. I don't play on a Friday or Saturday night. Because you know what? Life is about balance. And that's why I think my game right now is better than it's ever been in 10 years. It's because I'm in a happy marriage. I have a brilliant stepchild, Macy. And I go and play darts, and they let me do what I want to do when I go play for the real darts, which is TDC, long format, and I'm happy. The guys I work with, the only time I ever practice is when I'm at work. And the guys go, man, I've never seen you so happy to play darts. I went, hey, if you can't go and play long format and play for real money, what else do you want to do?
I got like that attitude.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. So, David, When you're talking about the future of darts, you know, you're a pretty farsighted guy. I mean, you've seen what's gone on in the past, and you're looking at the CDC now as something new, and what Red Eye Rhino is doing is something new. How optimistic are you as far as, you know, darts growing or becoming bigger in, say, the next 5 years? I mean, should we stop doing the show?
No, you know what? I'm stumbling because I've seen darts at its high peaks where I walked into a Sunday that was a three-man Superman team and seeing 100 teams, so 300 guys playing. We can't get 300 people in a weekend to play darts. I think when people start realizing the annual format, like, I don't understand when people say, hey, you have to pay this at this, and you have to pay this at that. My thinking to dart tournaments when I go to them, I said, why are you letting somebody that's not even here tell you how to run your dart tournament? So I'm optimistic because I love to see Red Eye Rhino coming and doing what they're doing. I mean, I met the guy. He came out there and we did an interview for the Premier Cup. And I didn't, you know, I met him a few years ago, but in the same way, it was, I think it was a two-way street. He got to learn more about me and I got to learn more about him. And I think Red Eye Rhino is the real deal. I think the CDC is a great step in the right direction. I think we need, for the CDC to go forward, we need to go to live streaming. Everything has to be instant feedback or post-production. I think somebody's going to come along. We alluded to this earlier. I met a guy, I did a little tour in Canada a couple of weeks ago, and I met a guy playing darts. He produces the NHL. He goes, hey, I got TV guys, I got camera guys. He goes, for $30,000, I can give us an amazing product. Well, who has $30,000 to throw at the production side of darts, right? So, you know, it's a catch-22. Players have to realize the game is bigger than you are. I realize that. I mean, if I never win a match again, I don't really care. I'm at the downside of my life in the darts where I would say, you know what? I would love to see guys do what I've done. I've been to 22 different countries. I've gotten to see brilliant things. But I think the game could still be a lot bigger. And I think it's in the right way. Like CDC and Red Rhino, Dartslive, even Phoenix. You know, every avenue that moves you forward, you have to support.
And then the avenues that aren't moving you forward, you should, like, stop
right.
supporting?
Exactly.
Should drop them like the dead duck the ADO is.
Nice. Yes. There you go.
Well.
I mean, let's be honest. You know, 2 out of 3, Steve, you know as well as I do, 2 out of 3 is not a dart game. It's a coin toss. Why don't I go up there and flip a coin 3 times and let you know if you won?
I would let you do that, David, but then you might win some off me. So
I'll give you odds.
I'm gonna have to play.
Get the crowd involved. We can get
hey,
some
you know what?
Going.
You know, it'd be great to see you in the CDC finals.
Well, I'll try to make it. I mean, I've been having some issues. I'm gonna try to make the one in Indianapolis, and if I qualify, then I'll go to the final. I don't know. It's not looking good for me, but I'm gonna try. I mean,
the thing is what I think what players have to take away from this moment in this conversation is that you hold your future. No one's going to do it for you. So you either have to get involved and promote the tours that you think will take you forward, whether that's the Dartslive on the soft hit side or the Phoenix or the CDC. Because we all know the ADO will never do one lick of work to make you a better dart player. What I say to every player that comes up to me now and asks me for a sponsorship, I said, what I want you to do is send me an email back saying how you will make $100,000 in the world of darts. Because I can tell you, I will send you an email that tells me how I make $100,000 playing darts.
Yeah, it's interesting. I haven't really thought that one through. Mm-hmm. $100,000?
Nobody does. Nobody ever does when I have that conversation with people. Because all they think about is, I want to have 5 shirts and 3 darts, 5 shirts and 5 sets of darts.
The shirts and the sets of darts crack me up. I played, you were there. You were in Nashville.
Yeah.
You saw me.
I win that CDC. Hold on.
Yeah.
Don't skip over that. I won that CDC Nashville.
Well, we did mention it on the show. We, yeah, I know you listen every week, but there was one episode you missed. So there's two things I want to run by you. The first thing is you chalked a match for me. I played Darren on Sunday in the cricket. Do you remember that at all?
Yeah, you should have won that easy, actually.
Did I mess up the end, not taking a whack at the 15?
You totally blew that match. You had that match so much that Darren started talking to you so you wouldn't win the match.
Oh, yeah? That's kind of gamesmanship, isn't it?
Yeah, it sounds like it.
Interesting.
Yeah, but you know what? You're a talker, so you're okay with that.
Yeah, I'm fine with it. I don't talk when I play. If
you know,
I did.
You in 3 rounds the next leg, though.
Say again? What do you say?
Dude, I don't want to repeat that.
Said
one.
You gave him 3 rounds.
Oh, yeah. The third leg, I kind of.
You can repeat it
totally...
because it's on tape, so yeah. It doesn't matter. It's not like we're not going to.
Yeah, we're
it.
Live, David. I don't edit this stuff either. I just put it out there. I go with, you know, we just go with it. The other thing was we did...
blew that match. You totally blew that match.
Yeah, I kind of thought I did. The other thing is we did a show a few weeks ago where I said that one thing you could do, and I was thinking in terms of the CDC, because the CDC, you get enough good players in a room where you could actually do this, and you're talking about live streaming and whatnot. I said what we should do is have some sort of a skills competition where let's say you put like 4 guys on 4 boards side by side. You say, ready, set, go, and the first guy to hit every double wins. And you get like a little speed trap, and then you get like 5 guys in a line behind a board, and they get 3 darts, and we measure to see who throws them the hardest, but they only count if you hit the bull. What was the other thing? Triples or something? We came up with, the first guy to get hit all the cricket triples and a double bull. Go. And I thought that would be a way to make darts accessible to, kind of non-darters or people that, you know, really have never given darts much of a thought. What do you think of something like that from a entertainment showmanship TV show kind of standpoint?
It's funny because the PDC is doing that now, actually. They have these little snippets that they do online with that, like the first one hit double bulls or blah, blah, blah. So is it in it? Yeah. Having 5 or 10, 15 guys before click, right?
Yeah.
Well, I've seen on Facebook like the PDC does that. They did that, but it was like more of a trick shot thing, like hitting a double bull left handed and it was all in fun. And is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, that's what we're all talking about.
Yeah.
No, I was thinking
this is more of
like the NHL skill shot.
Right? Yeah, or like the NBA three-point shot, dunk shot, you know, that kind of thing is kind of what I was thinking about. But then somebody said it was the stupidest idea he's ever heard. So I just wanted to get your take on it.
That's worth about 2 minutes on television.
2 minutes?
I mean, I think, like honestly, and I said it before, I think the picture of art comes from post-production and the people having real interviews. They're not saying, hey, I think this guy is great. I did this bit to the PDC when I was with him, like, 6, 7, 8 years ago. They go, oh, you want to introduce wrestling to darts? Well, the app that makes us $100,000 a year. That's why I tell everybody when they're doing things. So when you come back and tell me that you're going to make $100,000 a year in darts, because why not? You know what I mean? Like, why? If dart players start thinking about themselves as a product versus going, I'm a champion, then maybe we'll move forward. Maybe we'll get TV. There's no way that we're going to watch somebody with 8 kids on television that we can't watch a dart tournament.
Yeah, well, we've been saying that for a long time. I mean, I think there's space for us. I mean, I just, you know, I've had guys telling me that, well, we should only have cricket. And I'm like, well, cricket is too complicated for people to watch. 501 is like 9 ball. They're scoring all the time. There's a decisive shot every 2 minutes, and it moves quick. Cricket is like can be like watching paint dry. Mm-hmm. And then you have to commentate it. And cricket would be very difficult to commentate if you're playing fast and somebody's watching you that doesn't know what's going on. You know, every sport,
you're right.
Every sport that is televised that you can watch, even hockey, which moves very quickly, people that don't understand a lot about hockey, if they watch it and listen, can follow what's going on. I don't see how you could do that with cricket. With 0-1, I think it's more straightforward. You agree with that?
I do agree with that.
God, you look tired, dude.
Yeah, but the problem with 0-1 is it's boring.
How can you tell?
Is it boring?
It's boring. No one's boring. Oh, who's going to hit the most trouble? Cricket, to me, is a chess game. Guys can make shots. Like, I watched the World Stage this last weekend, and I think guys are going, like, why aren't you there? And I went, oh, it comes out of choices. I'm leaning towards steel tip right now. I'm playing so well, I want to go to the PDC. And if I can get back to the PDC, that would be amazing. But I watched the finals when Jeremiah was playing show, which I know both players, and Jeremiah had 6 opportunities to hit a perfect shot to go over that way. That was interesting. Because every time he lost the board, I went, this is his opportunity to take control of the match.
Yeah.
But you had to be informed, right? If they had a commentator that would say,
well, yeah.
Jeremiah, right here, you hit triple 15.
Yeah, I mean, that's always been my knock. That's always been my knock on Darts Live is that if you're not an astute player, you're not going to get much out of the game except who won. You know what I mean? And I always thought that was, and I don't know if I ever said that to Rob Heckman. I'm sure I did. That, you know, if they added commentary, it'd be imminently watchable, just the way they do it. You know, but I mean, you got to have somebody there like yakking. And, you know, there's plenty of guys that can yak. I mean, I'm not, you know, some better than others maybe, but David, we'll have to continue this another time.
Because... Yeah, no, it's fun. I really appreciate the phone call, and I really appreciate going on the show. I appreciate what you guys are doing for the game dart. Sometimes it gets lost, but it takes all the little things for people to get ahead, you know?
Yeah, well, we think of darts
as a
sport here.
Sorry, I missed something real quick. Was David promoting cricket?
Yeah, I think he was.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, I love cricket. I mean, I think cricket's a chess match. I mean, I went to the semifinals of a couple of years in the cricket nationals, and I keep thinking I'm a better cricket player than a 0-1 player, but I keep winning an 0-1 and never win cricket.
Yeah, I don't know. I think a lot of people from Canada look at cricket as a vacation because they play so much 0-1, and everybody needs some variety. I just think in America, you know, when half your time is spent playing cricket, it just... Everyone's 0-1 is going to suffer, you know?
Well, I can tell you this. Being in this country as long as I am, I'm a cricket player for it. I just happen to win more 0-1.
Well, you're still a dart player either way. I mean, you know.
Yeah. You know, and that, you know, here's a parting thought for people. If you change how you view the game and how you choose the dartboard, you may choose to have a different outcome.
All right.
Makes sense to you?
Sure. Yeah.
Well, David, I hope you'll come back on because you're one of the guys that would be perfect to talk about, you know, kind of the differences between soft tip and steel tip and stuff like that. We're not going to have enough time to get to it. But I hope you'll come back real soon because I really enjoyed this.
Hey, no, like I said, I had fun. I got the PDC extravaganza in 2 weeks. And then we got Indy. And then we got the CDC World Finals for the finals. And after I win the CDC Finals, maybe I'll come back on.
Okay, well, maybe you can come in live. Come to Chicago. It's not far from Indy. Fly into O'Hare.
That'd be brilliant.
Fly into O'Hare. And
I'm flying into O'Hare already.
Well, then just come by the studio. Fly in on a Wednesday.
There you go.
Fly in Wednesday. You could do the show Wednesday night. Or we could tape something, you know, if you're in town. We'll figure something out.
I'll look at my fireman schedule and see if I can make that happen for you, Steve.
All right, great. Thanks for coming on, David.
Thanks,
appreciate it. We'll talk to you soon.
I enjoyed it. I always enjoy our conversations because, like you said, me and you talk, people with...
Okay. Well, we'll talk. We'll talk again.
Usually because we're yelling at each other.
I try not to yell. I just raise my voice. Ask Holly Carver sometime. She's actually heard me yell. Ask her about that sometime. That's pretty funny. Anyway, well,
I think you guys are doing a great thing in darts, and continue to just do yours.
Well, thanks. We appreciate that. We'll talk to you soon, David.
All right, bye.
All the best.
Bye.
David Fatum, international dart player based in Arizona. Oh wow, that's good news.
What's that?
Well, Montero, who you think stinks?
Oh, you just homered.
Walk off. walk-off homer in extra innings.
There you go.
Anyway, thanks, everybody, for listening. I know we went long. Next week, we want to talk about the best rivalries in darts and some other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks to David Fatum for coming on. We'll have to get him on again. There's some other stuff I want
to
run by
him. I'm sure
him.
He's got a lot to say.
I was ready to argue with him about cricket, and I looked at the clock, and I'm like, we're out of time.
We don't have time for that.
But he would be a good guy. No one would ever come on the show and argue the merits of cricket against me. I think that'd be fascinating.
Right.
So we'll have to do that. Thanks again, everybody, for listening. We're going to wrap it up, and we will dart talk to everyone next week. Y'all take care.